The next item of business is a statement by Shona Robison on Scottish Government's provision of information to the COVID-19 inquiries. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Shona Robison, Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the loss and trauma experienced by people across Scotland throughout the COVID-19 pandemic cannot be overstated. We remember all those who have lost their lives or had them permanently changed. It's my hope that through the Scottish Government's cooperation with both the UK and Scottish COVID-19 public inquiries, that we can help provide some answers and some relief. I know the Chamber will appreciate that we would not normally make a statement regarding engagement with public inquiries while their proceedings are live. However, as the Minister responsible for COVID-19 inquiries, I'm making this statement to address issues raised by the UK inquiry at the preliminary hearing on the 26th of October and to give our reassurances on our commitment for a full response. In order to ensure the inquiries can take forward their necessary work without undue speculation, I hope the Chamber will also appreciate that we do not intend to provide a running commentary on the work of either inquiry. The Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19 in December 2021, ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry. It's important to note that both inquiries have made all their requests to witnesses in confidence, and those requests are not public. All those receiving requests, including the Scottish Government, have been told by the inquiries not to share their content. It's entirely up to and wholly a matter for the independent inquiry chairs to determine, where appropriate, whether to publish the material they receive. The Scottish Government is obliged to comply with this requirement, and as such, I will not and cannot provide precise details on any of the requests that the Scottish Government has received to date, including specific information on what has been asked of individuals who have received requests from the inquiries. Nor can I discuss in detail what materials individuals have or have not provided. Let me say from the offset, Presiding Officer, where there has been any lack of clarity from the Scottish Government about the material to be provided to the inquiries, then I do apologise to the families bereaved by COVID for any distress caused. That certainly was not our intention. The First Minister has reached out to the representatives of the Scottish COVID bereaved and offered a meeting to provide further reassurances where we can. What I can assure those families in this chamber is that the Scottish Government has and will work tirelessly to provide the UK inquiry with the materials it has requested. The material provided to the inquiry to date includes emails, messages, submissions and advice to ministers and papers from key decision-making meetings, including the Scottish Cabinet. In total, more than 19,000 documents have already been provided to the UK inquiry, and this figure continues to grow. The initial requests received from the UK inquiry focused on decision-making. As we have stated previously, it is not the culture within the Scottish Government to routinely use systems such as WhatsApp for decision-making. Decisions are routinely made in minuted meetings or through formal submissions to ministers. All relevant records of both of these have been provided to both inquiries already. The UK inquiry asked in June for summaries of all WhatsApp and similar groups related to coordination, logistics and day-to-day communication, greatly expanding the scope of what the Scottish Government needed to collate and process accordingly. This request was followed in September by a request for the actual messages exchanged within these groups. In examining the messages collated, it was clear that a number of them were of a particularly personal nature, including photos of individuals' children and personal medical details. In order to reconcile our obligations as data controller for the contents of the messages with our desire to cooperate fully with the inquiry, the Scottish Government wrote to the UK inquiry on the 5th of October requesting a Section 21 notice to provide the necessary legal basis for providing the information within the messages. The Scottish Government received the Section 21 notice yesterday, and I can confirm that work is well underway to fully comply in accordance with the timetable set by the UK inquiry. This will mean that all requested messages held will be shared in full and unredacted by the 6th of November. In addition to the hundreds of messages already handed over to the UK inquiry, this notice will allow us to share over 14,000, mainly WhatsApp, messages from various groups and individuals over the period of the pandemic, mostly concerning routine coordination of work and meetings by officials. I can confirm that messages from ministers and former ministers are included, but I have not seen them, nor should I, as that is for the inquiry. We will, of course, continue to fully cooperate with both inquiries and will share any additional messages should more become available or further material be requested. Following questions in Parliament last week, I would also like to highlight that the First Minister has asked the Permanent Secretary to ensure that all steps are being taken to meet the inquiry's requests and for the Solicitor General to satisfy herself that the Scottish Government has met all its legal obligations. It will be for individuals to explain to the inquiries any actions they have taken in relation to records retention. As the First Minister recently stated, should either COVID inquiry want more information, then we expect every minister, past and present, and every government official to comply. I can confirm that the First Minister will, when submitting his final statement for Module 2A in the coming days, hand over WhatsApp messages unredacted to the inquiry. Presiding Officer, I'd now like to offer some insight and reassurance regarding the handling and retention of records, including but not limited to informal communications by the Scottish Government. Scottish Government has clear record management policy, including transcribing and storing salient information from informal communications, such as evidence of decision-making, to a centralised record system. The Scottish Government's duty to create and retain records has remained consistent throughout the period looked at by the inquiries, and we've complied with that. The Scottish Government has maintained a detailed record and evidence of key decisions taken during the pandemic. Our policies fully comply with our legislative obligations under the Public Records Scotland Act 2011 and other legal obligations. The Scottish Government's records management policy makes clear what must be recorded in the official record, as it is not practical, cost-effective or necessary for any organisation to retain every single exchange that everyone working within that organisation creates. To be crystal clear, there is not and has never been a need for material without business value to be retained as part of the corporate record. Colleagues exchanging pleasantries, chatting electronically about inconsequential or personal matters while working from home during lockdown should not be retained. No government, no organisation of any size routinely retains that material because it has no business use. It should also be noted that there are clear legal requirements not to retain data, and particularly personal data, for which there is no legitimate purpose. These legal requirements are statutory and UK-wide. Prior to the development of a dedicated mobile messaging policy in November 2021, the retention of mobile messages was covered in the Scottish Government's record management policy. The records management policy continues to apply to all records. The guidance has always been clear that regardless of the platform, information relevant to the corporate record must be saved. The mobile messaging policy drafted by civil servants is intended to ensure responsible and effective use of messaging applications. It's consistent with and supplements the established records management policy. This policy covers a range of applications used on mobile devices, including but not limited to WhatsApp. The policy does not prohibit the use of messaging applications, but requires people to consider the benefits and risks of using these apps and to ensure that any usage is compliant with records management responsibilities and data protection requirements. This policy encourages consideration of security and privacy when using mobile messaging apps, including whether the application allows for the automatic deletion of messages after a set period to address the risk of messages being misused if a mobile device is lost or compromised. Let me be clear, however. that contrary to some reports, there is not and has not ever been a requirement for any official, let alone ministers, to auto-delete messages without ensuring that relevant information from them is captured and saved appropriately first. The Scottish Inquiry wrote to the Scottish Government's Permanent Secretary on the 5th of August 2022, requesting that all material of potential relevance to the inquiry be retained. The UK inquiry to date has not written to the Scottish Government with a specific request for record retention. However, the UK Government wrote to permanent secretaries in each devolved administration in June 2021, February 2022 and October 2022, asking that material of potential relevance to the inquiry should not be destroyed. These requests were cascaded through the Scottish Government, and the significance and importance of storing material of potential relevance was made known to all relevant staff, as was the instruction that this material should be saved on the official record. For the avoidance of any doubt, the Scottish Government has consistently acted in line with its records management policies and relevant legal obligations with regards to the collating and storing of corporate information. Presiding Officer, before closing, I would like to note my gratitude to those working in the UK and Scottish COVID-19 inquiries. I'm conscious of both the immense responsibility they hold and the enormity of the tasks they face in understanding and distilling the events of the pandemic and the lessons that can be taken away. We all stand to benefit from the work that they take forward on our behalf, and I'm pleased with the constructive relationship that has developed between both inquiries and Scottish Government officials, including in the context of challenging deadlines and detailed scrutiny. I'm happy to reiterate the Scottish Government's pledge to continue the highest standard of cooperation already established with both public inquiries, those affected by the pandemic, particularly those who bore some form of loss, have placed a great deal of trust in the Scottish Government, not just to take on the challenges that COVID-19 posed, but also to be open and accountable about our performance. That trust is of the most importance to me and to the Scottish Government, and we will continue to work to make sure that we are acting accordingly. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm now happy to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 30 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The UK and Scottish COVID inquiries were set up to give answers to thousands of families who lost loved ones during the pandemic and everyone who suffered. They must be at the forefront of our thoughts today. And I also want to state at this point that the Scottish Conservatives believe it should be the First Minister delivering this statement today and being held accountable in this Parliament today. With respect to evidence to the inquiries, Nicola Sturgeon, who is in the chamber today, promised in August 2021 that nothing would be off limits, including WhatsApp messages. But now the stench of secrecy from this government is overpowering. Yep. Because at the weekend, it was revealed that Nicola Sturgeon had manually deleted messages. And it's also been revealed that Scotland's most senior clinician, Jason Leach, also deleted WhatsApp messages on a daily basis. So while today the Deputy First Minister has said the SNP government will now provide 14,000 WhatsApp messages, almost a year after they were originally asked for, does that figure include all messages from Nicola Sturgeon, from Jason Leach and any others who had deleted messages? If so, how were they recovered? If not, how does the Deputy First Minister defend this cover-up? We know that in June 2021, the Scottish Government were told not to destroy any communication relating to the pandemic. So can the Deputy First Minister tell us if any messages were destroyed after that date? If they were, does the Deputy First Minister accept that any SNP minister or former minister, including Nicola Sturgeon, would have broken the law if they had done so? And finally, many of the issues that are causing concern just now relate to disappearing messages. We've seen correspondence which suggests that the Deputy First Minister herself has had disappearing messages turned on her WhatsApp account. Is that true? And does she still have disappearing messages turned on her WhatsApp account? Thank you.
Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Where I do agree with Douglas Ross is that the families are at the forefront of this. And that is why it is important that we give as much information as is possible to give. And that's why 19,000 documents have, of course, already been given. And I need to explain again something that I explained in my statement. And that is that the first tranche of queries and asks from the inquiry related to decision-making. That was the response of the 19,000 documents to that request. It was then in June that the inquiry of this year, that the inquiry came back asking for groups of WhatsApp messages, what the title of those groups were, and who were members of those groups. It was then September, when they came asking for those individual messages. So it's not correct to say that it's been a year since that request was made. It has only been just over a month. We then had to ask for the Section 21 order because of the nature of those messages. That order came in yesterday, and those 14,000 WhatsApp messages will be given to the inquiry by the deadline of the 6th of November. Now, I said in my statement very clearly that I cannot say who those messages are from and what the content is because I'm not allowed to. I don't see them. That is a confidential set of information requests.
Deputy First Minister, can I just ask members to ensure that we can all hear the Deputy First Minister?
That is the confidential nature of what the inquiry has asked for. If I was to breach that and ask for information from officials that do not share that information with anyone, that would be a breach of the confidential requirements of the inquiry itself. So I don't know who those 14,000 messages are from, other than they do include ministers and former ministers and officials. The only person I do know of that has provided those and will provide those WhatsApp messages as the First Minister himself, because he has publicly stated so. Beyond that, I don't know who those 14,000 WhatsApp messages relate to. If those are published, that is in the gift of the inquiry itself, and they will decide whether or not any of those messages are released. In terms of the disappearing messages. Let me say this. In terms of my use of WhatsApp with my private office, for example, any decision around I ask for information or I ask for something to be taken forward, that is then recorded on the system, because otherwise it wouldn't happen. So it is recorded on the system. Other messages like, do I want a coffee or what is my time of arrival, we wouldn't hold on to those messages because that wouldn't comply with the data management policy. So I hope I've managed to give Douglas Ross the answers to his questions that he asked.
Thank you. I call Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, evidence being taken at the UK COVID inquiry today demonstrates why transparency in government is just so important. People were discharged to care homes without testing, too many people died, and people lost their livelihoods. So we absolutely need to understand why decisions were taken and what happened so we can learn lessons for the future. Bereaved families were promised nothing less than full cooperation by the Scottish Government with both the UK and Scottish inquiries, yet they have been treated with disrespect. Promised transparency and a guarantee from the First Minister that all messages would be handed over, but instead the Government and individual ministers have so far failed to deliver. Messages from those closest to the decision-making have been destroyed on an industrial scale. And what we've seen instead is what can only be construed as deliberate and coordinated withholding of information. A public inquiry was talked about in May 2020. Why did ministers not retain evidence from then? The Deputy First Minister points to individual responsibility to cooperate with the inquiry. But surely it is the collective responsibility of the Scottish Government to ensure that its own procedures are followed, not least by the former First Minister and former Deputy First Minister. Does she agree with me that it is inconceivable that a former First Minister would not understand the importance of that evidence? And finally, Presiding Officer, have all of the 70 people in the 137 WhatsApp groups, ministers, special advisers and civil servants, been issued with individual Section 21 notices, or was this to the Scottish Government? And does that include the First Minister and Deputy First Minister? And can she confirm that you will be able to comply fully and have not destroyed any evidence?
Deputy First Minister.
So let me agree with Jackie Bailey, first of all, that in the midst of all this are families who have lost loved ones and have been profoundly affected. Many of us have families affected ourselves. So it's not in my interest or the Scottish Government's interest to not provide that information. And we have already provided 19,000 documents about decision-making and 14,000 WhatsApp, at least 14,000 WhatsApp messages will be provided by the 6th of November. The Section 21 order covers all of those messages because of the nature of the sensitivity of some of that personal information that is required. As I said in my statement, the Permanent Secretary and the Solicitor General have also been asked for reassurance in terms of the policy being followed. Ultimately, it is the requirement of each individual to comply with the policy. The recommendations and requirements were made very clear to everybody concerned. And the inquiry itself can, of course, interrogate the information provided to them by individuals in the course of the hearings if they consider it relevant to do so. But for the Scottish Government's purposes, I have set out in great detail in my statement what the policy, the management of information policy was, and the requirement and the clarity to ministers and officials of their requirement to follow that policy.
Thank you. I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I take this opportunity to put on record my condolences to the families who have been bereaved, and I hope that the inquiries can provide the answers they so desperately need. And I'm grateful that the First Minister has committed to handing over whatever the COVID inquiry asks for. This in contrast to the Prime Minister's attempts earlier this year to block Baroness Hallett's request for information. Given the concerns that the representatives of bereaved family members have highlighted, can the Deputy First Minister give an assurance that the Scottish Government is doing everything it can to provide maximum transparency?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, can I say, that, as I said in my statement, that the Scottish Government is wholly committed to cooperating with both the UK and Scottish COVID-19 public inquiries and will continue to fully comply with all requests for information that we receive. As I've said on a couple of occasions now, that's why the Scottish Government has already provided more than 19,000 records to the UK COVID-19 inquiry, and we're providing more than 14,000 messages by the 6th of November, now that the inquiry has provided a legally compliant way for us to be able to do that. And we'll continue to work with both inquiries to ensure that we respond fully to any future requests that come in beyond the information already provided.
Call Megan Gallagher to be followed by John Mason.
Presiding Officer, last week the SNP Government told the COVID inquiry in reference to WhatsApp messages that relevant information would be recorded in the Scottish Government's electronic records and document management system. Deputy First Minister, the public deserve to know the truth. How many WhatsApps were saved through the Scottish Government's electronic records and document management process in relation to the pandemic? Have any of these messages been subsequently deleted from that record? And will the COVID inquiry be given full access to these records?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I went through in quite some detail in my statement how the records policy works, and that is the responsibility of the official the Minister and indeed the Minister's private office to make sure that anything that is material that is discussed on WhatsApp is recorded on the record management system. I should say, as I said in my statement, that WhatsApp is not routinely used for government decision making, and you can see why. Because anything that is about a decision has to go in the system, otherwise it won't be acted upon. So it's not routinely used for decision making. I have set out clearly the expectation of every single person that was required to follow that policy. I've set out how that was communicated. Ultimately, it is the requirement of each individual to comply with the policy that was clearly set out. And as I said in a previous answer, of course, the inquiry itself can interrogate the information provided to them by any individual in the course of the hearings if they choose to do so.
John Mason, to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much. The Finance Committee recently held an inquiry into government decision-making, and I wonder if the Deputy First Minister would agree with what I think was the committee's feelings, that there does need to be space for informal chats and sharing ideas. And can she say how we get the balance right between formal discussions which should be properly recorded and informal discussions which need not be?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, John Mason makes a reasonable point that free and open discussions between ministers and officials in both formal and informal manners are a key part of the functioning of government and other organisations. And they help ensure the generation of ideas and solutions that are a very quick way of communicating. But if any decision or anything that is pertinent to the organisation is discussed, then that should be recorded on the information management system. The Scottish Government already has record management policies that are extensive and that ensure that any discussions with corporate value, particularly those around policy decisions, are transcribed and stored in the corporate record appropriately. That's how WhatsApp or any other Teams or any other platform should be used. And as I said in my statement, the Permanent Secretary and the Solicitor General are making sure and assuring the First Minister and the Scottish Government that that is the case and that that is fully understood by everyone in the organisation going forward.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Do not destroy notices were issued to ministers and officials in August 2022. In her answers so far, the Deputy First Minister has been clear that it's a matter of individual responsibility as to whether they comply or not. So can the Deputy First Minister tell the Chamber how many individuals have complied and how many individuals have yet to comply?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, as I said clearly in my statement, I have no sight of any of that information because it would be against the inquiry's rules for me to have any of that. The requests.
Let's hear the Deputy First Minister.
This is really important, and it's important that you understand, the Chamber understands this point. Rule 9 requests come from the inquiry to the individual. No one is cited on the content of that, and no one is cited on what the response is. That is completely confidential. It would be quite wrong of me to ask
Deputy
to see
First Minister, those... Sorry, I would be grateful if members could allow us all to hear the Deputy First Minister respond, and that can be difficult when others are talking at the same time. Deputy First Minister.
This is actually a very serious matter. A very serious matter.
Members...
It's a very serious matter, and it's very important that people understand the nature of an inquiry. The inquiry itself is the guardian of the information of what they request from whom and what they receive back. That is confidential. I will have no sight of that, so I do not know, for example, how
Mr. Johnson.
Many ministers, past or present, are included in those 14,000 WhatsApp messages, because I have no sight of that. I have no sight of who they are and what the contact or content is. And neither should I, because if I was to, that would be a breach of the inquiry rules. That is how an inquiry works. And I think perhaps it might be helpful for us to circulate some information exactly about how the inquiry works, because if people don't understand that basic concept, then we have a problem about the confidential nature of the information being provided.
Before I move to the next question, members will appreciate there is a great deal of interest in the statement. There are many members wishing to put questions, so we will require concise questions and responses. And I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you. The First Minister was clear last week, as the Deputy First Minister has been clear today, that the Scottish Government decisions were not routinely made over WhatsApp, which is very welcome. We know that this hasn't necessarily been the case elsewhere in the UK. Can the Deputy First Minister provide an update regarding steps being taken to reinforce this practice across government?
Deputy First Minister.
So the Scottish Government has internal practices to ensure that all record keeping around decision making follows those internal policies that I referred to in some detail in my statement, as well as legal requirements for information management. The record management policy is available to all staff on the Scottish Government's intranet, as well as being available to the public on gov.scot. We will, of course, reinforce these practices following the statement from today going forward, with an all-staff communication to be issued reminding officials of their responsibilities to ensure good record-keeping practices are maintained. And yes, that does apply to ministers as well. And the interaction between ministers and their private office and the private offices making sure that any decision-making is recorded is a really important interaction within government. And that is what I reiterated in my statement earlier.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Emma Harper.
Presiding Officer, thousands of grieving families are looking to these inquiries for answers, and UK government WhatsApps show minute by minute what was really going on behind the scenes and how decisions were made. It shows that the discussions behind an order were often as important as the order itself. Did those life and death judgments ever hinge around Nicola Sturgeon's desire just to be different from Boris? We may never know, because, Presiding Officer, messages deleted at the very top of the Scottish Government erased the process by which ministers weighed the politics and the science behind the decisions required of them. If anyone else had acted in such a conspiratorial way, the SNP would now be in uproar. Presiding Officer, this will all come out in the wash. So can I ask the Deputy First Minister if she personally believes those grieving families will ever see the correspondence of most importance to them, that being all relevant messages to and from Nicola Sturgeon?
Deputy First Minister.
What I can agree with Alec Cole-Hamilton on is that families are looking for answers, and indeed he's right about the context of some of that decision making. And that is why the 14,000 WhatsApp messages that I referred to in my statement, and that will grow without a doubt, are so important, because some of that, I think, will provide the context of the environment that decisions were being made in. And the inquiry will see all of that. They will see the First Minister's WhatsApp messages, which he will provide as part of his final statement to the inquiry. What I don't know is what the inquiry itself will put in the public domain, because that is a matter for the inquiry. They might put all of it in the public domain, they might put none of it in the public domain. That is for the inquiry, because the information is their information in terms of what it was requested, what they hold, and then what they will release. That is for the inquiry, not for the Scottish Government.
Emma Harper to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. A substantial number of people will be involved in government decision-making processes. So can the Deputy First Minister advise what engagement has been undertaken with civil servants to ensure that their views inform robust decision-making processes?
Deputy First Minister.
So all civil servants receive training to ensure that ministers are receiving the best possible advice. That includes training in using data and evidence and working with partners and communities so that the advice coming to ministers has the relevant information and different views and perspectives. The civil service also regularly works with external experts too, who can peer review information and ensure that ministers receive high quality advice on which to base decisions. The advice, as I said earlier, is then stored within the corporate record in line with our records management policy. That is the crucial part of how decisions are recorded. I've made that point a number of times because the importance of it cannot be understated.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you. The First Minister said yesterday that there was a policy of deleting social media messages after 30 days. But in her statement, the Deputy First Minister has told us that policy was introduced in November 2021, after the height of the pandemic was over. So can the Deputy First Minister confirm that anyone in the Scottish Government, whether a minister or a civil servant, who deleted messages before that date would be in breach of the Government's records management policy?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the records management policy, as I set out in detail in my statement, is very clear. And it's very clear that WhatsApp is not routinely used as a decision-making tool. But any decision made, whether it's on WhatsApp or any other platform, had to be recorded on the official management system. That has always been the case. Nothing has changed in relation to that. The issue of that I pointed out in my statement around the deletion of messages is around being able to distinguish between messages about cups of coffee or when someone's arriving at an event from important information that is about decision making or has corporate value. And that is a distinction made because no organisation in the world will retain every single WhatsApp conversation between every individual in its organisation. It just wouldn't. So the policy is clear about what has to be retained and where it has to be retained. That has always been the policy. And I could not be clearer about that. And in relation to the messages that will be handed over, they will be of, some of that will be in the category of chit-chat on WhatsApp. Some of it will be more pertaining to the context of decisions that were being made at the time. All of that information that the Scottish Government holds will be given to the inquiry by the 6th of November, and any other information requested beyond that, the Scottish Government will do its best to provide the inquiry with any of that additional information requested.
Willie Coffey to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Can the Deputy First Minister provide any further information about steps which are being taken to ensure that there is a comprehensive understanding of the Scottish Government's record management policy across government, including any further guidance in the use of messaging or other apps for any relevant purposes?
Deputy First Minister.
So, senior officials have issued a number of emails to staff, reminding them of their obligation to understand and adhere to the Scottish Government's record management policy. Detailed advice on this policy and others related to it are available to all staff via their intranet. The Scottish Government's senior information risk owner is also preparing a further all-staff communication to be issued to direct officials towards this information to make sure that everyone is reminded about the key aspects of the Scottish Government's records management policy.
Gillian Mackay to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
It's critical that in this important discussion we're all clear exactly how and where Scottish Government decisions are made and how these decisions are recorded and acted upon. Can the Deputy First Minister clarify whether decisions were made on WhatsApp during the COVID pandemic and what safeguards were in place to ensure good governance standards were adhered to during the height of the crisis?
Deputy First Minister.
So let me be clear again that WhatsApp is not routinely used as a decision-making tool. And the reason for that is that a decision, if a minister wants a decision to be acted upon, it has to go into the system to be acted upon. So that is why any decision communicated, for example, to a private office from a minister will then be transcribed into the system so it can be acted upon. So if there were any decisions made, that would be the process to make sure that it would be put into the system. And that would happen not just in terms of WhatsApp messages, but if there was a communication, a conversation, a phone call that had to then be followed up by action, that would be recorded into the management system to make sure that was then acted upon.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Katie Clark.
The independence of the inquiry is paramount. However, the need to gather accurate, reflective detail can lead to long timescales for any inquiry. Can the Deputy First Minister set any expectations as to timescales for those relatives desperate for answers?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I very much understand the desire to see the findings and lessons learned from both inquiries as soon as possible. And this is a key underpinning of the Scottish Government's desire as well. Section 17 of the 2005 Inquiries Act gives, an inquiry chair alone, rather than ministers, responsibility for deciding how an inquiry should operate. Therefore, operational matters such as the timetabling and timescales of the inquiry's work are for the chair to decide, entirely independent of government.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Alistair Allen.
The Deputy First Minister has not made clear whether the Scottish Government complied with its own policy, which is that salient WhatsApp messages should be saved at least on the centralised record system. Could the Deputy First Minister confirm that this is normally what happens and confirmed whether it happened in relation to COVID messages? And can she confirm whether COVID records policy was reviewed on receipt of the Do Not Destroy notices?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, on that final point, any further information and requirements would have been cascaded through the organisation to make sure that everyone was fully aware of their need to comply. As I've said throughout my statement and then the follow-up questions, that the guidance has always been really clear about what should be transcribed from WhatsApp messages. It is ultimately the requirement of each individual to comply with the policy. As I have said, if there's any concerns from the inquiry, once they have all the information in front of them that they feel that has not been the case, then of course they can interrogate the information provided to them by individuals or not provided to them by individuals in the course of the hearings if they consider it's relevant to do so. So anything that the Scottish Government was asked for that we had has either already been handed over in the 19,000 documents or will be handed over in the 14,000 WhatsApp messages now we have the Section 21 legal underpinning in place to be able to do so.
Alistair Allen, to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Can the Deputy First Minister advise what steps have been taken or indeed changes made to maximise transparency in terms of the Scottish Government's records management policy and processes?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government continually acts to make sure its own policies and processes are fully understood. In aid of this, the Scottish Government's records management policy is available to officials, as I said earlier, on the staff intranet and to the public via gov.scot. I'm also happy to confirm that the Scottish Government has published its mobile messaging policy on gov.scot this afternoon to make sure the wider public can see that.
Sandesh Gulhani, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
I'd like to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP, which I performed during the pandemic. The current First Minister told reporters that government policy was that they should delete WhatsApp messages. But in response to my question in December 2022 about whether WhatsApp messages are covered by FOIs, George Adams said all recorded information that is held by ministers or officials, including WhatsApp, that relate to the business of Scottish Government, is subject to FOI requests. So, Deputy First Minister, how can I FOI messages that are deleted?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, in some ways, the member answered his own question because he said relating to the business of the Scottish Government. And that is the key point here. Anything contained on WhatsApp or Teams or anything else relating to the business of the Scottish Government should be transcribed.
Members.
The deletion issue, of course, as I set out in my statement, is about all of the other information not relating to the business of the Scottish Government, which no organisation would keep. And we meet our legal obligations in regard to the deletion of that information that doesn't relate to the business of the Scottish Government, because it's very clear that the advice and policy and the legalities are that organisations should not hold on to information that does not relate to the business of the organisation concerned.
I call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. How many individuals involved in government have failed to comply with the Scottish Government's internal processes, including the Scottish Government records management policy, since February 2021?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, as I've said already to a number of questions, only the inquiry knows what they asked for and what has been provided. I have no sight of that. I have no oversight of what the inquiry has asked for, because that is direct to the individual through a Rule 9 order, and that information goes back to them. In terms of the wider ask of the inquiry about what the Scottish Government holds more generally, then all of the information asked for by the inquiry held by the Scottish Government has been provided in relation to decision-making, 19,000 documents already provided. That wider ask about all communication on WhatsApp and other message platforms is being provided through the over 14,000 messages that will be provided by the 6th of November timeframe.
And Stephen Kerr.
The Deputy First Minister can't confirm whether or not the former First Minister manually deleted her WhatsApp messages, as was reported in the press at the weekend. So would the Deputy First Minister agree that it would be in order for the former First Minister to make a personal statement to this Parliament as to whether or not she deleted her WhatsApp messages, as has been reported?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I have made clear throughout my statement and throughout all of the answers to all of the questions that I can't comment on any individual, because I don't know what they've been asked for, I don't know what they have provided, and I don't know any of that information, because I shouldn't know, because it is a confidential matter between...
Members, let us hear the Deputy First Minister. Let's conduct our business in an orderly manner.
It is a confidential matter between the inquiry and the individual concerned about what was asked for and what was provided. And I'd imagine if I was to suddenly be asking for all of that information to be given to me, then members across this chamber would be asking me why I was breaching the rules of the independent inquiry. The rules are clear. It is confidential information that no one other than the inquiry, the person concerned, and indeed the group of officials who are working completely independent of ministers to provide that information. And those are clear channels of communication. And I think the chair of the inquiry would take a very dim view if we were to do anything other than that.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 11043 on committee membership and 11044 on substitution on committees.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and both moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 11027.1 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, which seeks to amend Motion 11027 in the name of Paul McLennan on Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, we will have a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.